There we go. Okay.
I think it's great. I invited Kevin to come to this meeting so he could provide feedback, but now he's half muted, so okay. He'll have to sit in the and listen to whatever I say. I do enjoy iNaturalist. As I say, my background is with traditional data sets and marine species, so wild flora is a little bit different. But the sort of why this talk, I think it's probably because I've been talking about iNaturalist forever, and I think you guys finally gave up and sort of say, okay, give a presentation. So this is, I would like to introduce iNaturalist. I think it's a great tool, and I think that you will find it useful once you try it a couple of times. There is a direct connection I can see between iNaturalist and the Wild Flora Society. I did dig around a little bit today. You see, I found one of your old pages that was backed up from a few years ago. I don't see that you currently share lots of images of species. And I think originally you had this great goal to obtain high quality photographs of all species in Nova Scotia. And I think this is something that iNaturalist can provide for you. And I think that by looking at all the observations on iNat, you can get a wide range of photographs and encourage people.
Just leave it alone.
I think there will be a good connection. I should also say that normally when people give presentations or try to talk to me, I have a tendency to interrupt a lot. So please feel free to interrupt me at any time. I'm not sure if you're aware, but the Government of Canada does have a portal for citizen science projects. And on this site, this is where you'd expect to find things like Frog Watch and the Monarch Butterfly Watches and various things. But if you go there and if you filter these projects for iNaturalist, you come up with two major projects. The one on the bottom is iNaturalist Canada, and it's the one I'm going to be talking about today. And the other one at the top is BC Parks iNaturalist Project. And it is a project that everybody should be keeping an eye on because they are doing a fantastic job out in the West Coast. They have lots of money, lots of people, and they're getting their entire community to get out and explore their BC parks and to share observations. And this is something that I hope at some point here in Nova Scotia that we can replicate. You know, we recently had a presentation, one of the past meetings, from someone from the parks and there are many that we can explore locally. There's a lot of information online about iNaturalist and the online content is probably much better than anything I can share. But basically iNaturalist is an opportunity for anybody to take a picture or record a sound and share that observation. Quite often you hear talking about sharing observations using the app. Personally, I don't use the mobile phone. I use a real camera and upload my content online. So every time people create a poster like this that is promoting iNaturalist, I make them add that little bit saying where it says on here, using a smartphone or digital camera. I always make sure they put the digital camera in there because I think that the online feature is very important. I will say that when I first started using iNaturalist, I couldn't take good pictures with my camera. So I blamed it because it was out of date. So I did go out and invest in a brand new cell phone. And it works reasonably well. But you can't take pictures of eagles across the lake with a cell phone. So I have a tendency to do that. May work well for plants. It is quite often you'll see they're changing the word now citizen science to community science. But basically we are all citizens of the world. So it's not limiting to people that are from this particular area. We want to encourage people to share observations. So you can record evidence and you can record sounds, not plants probably, so photos are probably the main feature that you wish to look at and of any living thing. So my neighbor always wants to post pictures of her favorite rock that's heart-shaped that she found in Cape Breton. I keep saying, no, you cannot post that on iNaturalist. But I do sometimes say, well, if you move it next to a plant, you can have it in the background. You can upload other evidence. So you could upload pine cones or various things along that line. And it may seem strange to sort of say that to this group that you can post photos of scat, but maybe when you're out looking for trees and various other things, you do come across bear scat, better the scat than the bear, or that you see various tracks in the snow. So this is an opportunity to share observations of species that you weren't initially looking for. You will learn over time to take better pictures. The initial ones sometimes are a little bit out of focus, or you don't know what features to include. So these are things that that comes with practice. They say there's lots of help on the iNaturalist website, but at any time, reach out to any local iNatter and I'm sure they'll help you. There's also ways to learn more about the species. So you may just have the name, but if you click on it, I'll show you that later, you'll come up with a lot of information about the species. There are many projects that you can join or that your observations may automatically feed into, and we can discuss that as well. The major project that I will discuss tonight is the City Nature Project, and hopefully everybody will sign up to join that project before the night is over. The other feature that my cat does not like closed doors, and I close the door here, hang on. One of the features in iNaturalist is that you can create your own lists of species that you've seen in a particular area, a particular time. So because I enjoy going out looking for birds these days, I have a list that I keep refreshing. It's of all the birds that I've seen this year. So I can see whether I have seen 100 different species or 150, or you know, if I have more observations of Iceland gulls and David McCorkadale, or whether or not I have more certain species than Kevin has. It's a good tool. Nice to be competitive. And the cat's coming to talk now. So I'll just keep on going here.
Excuse me, if you are using a camera, do you have to also record your location?
When I first started using my camera, I didn't have that ability, but my memory wasn't too bad. So I usually knew, okay, these five pictures were taken down at Sullivan's Pond. These were over at Chuby Park. And so I could then go and create a dot on the map and make a big circle to say where they were located. Because if I was taking a picture of a dandelion or a Norway maple, I don't think it really mattered exactly where I was. But I have since learned how to use all trails. So I've synced my camera timestamp and my cell phone so that I can, when I come home in about 5 or 10 minutes, I can just sync them all. Then I have the true locations for every observation I collected. Does that help? Anyway, I can share that method with others. One of the things about collecting species distribution information is that the scientists who are interested in these locations can't be everywhere. So this is something that we can help by posting our observations. And this is something that the Canadian Wildlife Federation is really promoting. I don't know if you can see that, if it's covered by our pictures there. So iNaturalist is Canada's largest data set covering different species. So most people know of eBird, but the eBird is focusing just on birds. So to date, 6.9 million observations, that's not too bad. And if you want to look at the counts from this particular year, oh, I have my pictures are in way again here. Here. In 2022, we've posted over 78,000 observations of over 3,500 species. Does everyone else have this problem that the thumbnails of people's pictures is always in the way of the screen picture? Maybe it's just me. In iNaturalist, you have the ability to keep track of your encounters with other organisms and keep these life lists. You can interact with other experts who help you identify what you have observed. You can learn about what you are posting, and you can create useful data. The iNaturalist Canada website has, as I say, lots of information, and their goal in choosing to create this or promote this portal is that they wanted to find a good platform to share information that all Canadians could use. In 2015, they did an extensive review of all the citizen science projects that were out there, and they adopted iNaturalist. They took iNaturalist itself was created in California, and it was a grad student's project. It then grew, and in 2017, it was really promoted in Canada as part of the Canada 150 BioBits. The iNaturalist Canada is made up of four groups and their steering committee: the Canadian Wildlife Federation, Parks Canada, NatureServe Canada, and the Royal Ontario Museum. But all the data resides in the California Academy of Sciences and is supported by the National Geographic Society. And I should say that I am retired. I am not affiliated with CWF or any other organization. You can read all of this information online without having to log in or sign up. It's all freely accessible. What I like about iNaturalist is that the data, it flows to a larger aggregator, and it flows to this giant repository called the Global Biodiversity Information Facility, GBIF. This is where most research data sets end up. eBird flows to here, as do many university and other databases. This is just a quick picture of the data that is in GBIF for iNaturalist. You'll see that it's a little light in the ocean area, so that is something I need to work on, but it is lots of data in the North America area. If you were to click on that link and zoom into Nova Scotia, you'll see that there are many dots, there are a couple of gaps, but if you keep on this link and it keeps zooming in and in and in, you will eventually be able to see probably where I live, where David lives, where Kevin lives. You'll be able to see where our summer cottage is, because there'll be more and more points. You can probably see where Beth Sheila has been sampling in various areas in Cape Breton. The City Nature Challenge is a global project that started in California in 2016, I believe. That was just a competition between two friends, two museums in Los Angeles and San Francisco. And they threw out the competition: we can do better than you can around Earth Day. Let's see how many people we can get out, see how many observations we can record, and how many species we can find. And the next year it went across the states, and then the following year it became international. And I believe in that year, there were only two entries from Canada, one in the high school in Richmond, British Columbia, and Calgary. The following year, 2019, we registered Halifax. And the reason we did that was because I really wanted to promote iNaturalist to the marine community and to get people in our coastal areas sharing observations. But it was incredibly difficult to share that message for reasons primarily that iNaturalist focuses on terrestrial species and terrestrial place names. So in 2019, we decided, okay, let's try the City Nature Challenge, but let's choose areas that do include a bit of the coast. And that's why our definition for Halifax is all of HRM, including Sable Island and CBRM and the valley. So our bit was primarily to encourage people just to get outdoors. If that happens in April, that's fantastic. Let's encourage people to get to explore different parts of the province or of HRM, try different trails, different parks, different areas. With COVID, it's also been exploring your own backyard. and we need to learn how to observe nature. I did at one point encourage a neighbor of mine to get out and to take pictures of wildlife. She went out and wandered around for about 20 minutes and came home and said, I didn't see anything wild. So I think there's a little bit of information we have to share with people around us. So you can share your observations using the app or go online. And one of the important things here is, aside from staying safe, to respect wildlife. And I think tomorrow night, Nature Nova Scotia is giving a presentation from Hope for Wildlife about respecting wildlife. And this is just an excellent opportunity to introduce iNaturalist to the local community. And it's my excuse for chatting with you tonight. So now you might say, why should we use iNaturalist? We're quite happy using whatever means we've used forever. This is your basic, I guess, code of conduct that I could find on your webpage. And this is what iNaturalist promotes. They say that their primary goal in operating iNaturalist is to connect people with nature. This sounds very similar to what you're attempting to do as well. The secondary goal is to generate scientifically valuable biodiversity data. Now, the reason that this is secondary is because I might go out and post a very poor picture, but it did help me learn a little bit about nature. Here's my cat. Everybody's being very quiet and muted, so I feel like I'm just speaking to the cat here. iNaturalist is a community, and it will only work if all parts of the community contribute. So I may be posting lots of pictures, but I'm hoping that other people, not just Burkhardt, but will get out and help identify what I have shared. Now we do have to, as contributors, have to remember to read the feedback we get from the people who put the effort in to identify. And we have to try to improve over time and not just to say plant. And by choosing iNaturalist, we can also help try to reduce a little bit duplication of effort. There's so many organizations that say, if you see this species, please take a picture of it and send it to me. All that needs to happen is take the picture, put down iNaturalist, and then all researchers anywhere in the world working on anything can easily find it. The difference between iNaturalist and eBird, you requires a bit of expertise for you to say that I saw a certain species of birds. In iNaturalist, you don't have to do that. You can post a picture and say bird, plant, maple tree, something along that line. But you must have evidence to back up your observation. So you can have a photo or sound recording. If and when somebody adds a name to one of your observations, you shouldn't necessarily click it and agree. You should take out your guidebook and go through and try to figure out how could they tell that was a sugar maple versus a Norway maple? You know, what are the features that I need to look at in order to make that decision? And over time, you'll start to take better pictures that include these features. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail about how to identify observations on iNaturalist because we could get really bogged down here. But what I can say is that anybody can go on iNaturalist, and if you don't know the species name, you can still add valuable information. You can help annotate the observations. And I'm putting sea urchins in here because maybe when you're walking along the coastline looking for different species, you may see some sea urchins that were dropped by gulls. So you might take a picture, you might wish to post it. Now, if you're posting a picture of this sea urchin, it's probably useful to say that it's dead because otherwise you might drive my colleagues were interested in sea urchins nuts because you'd be implying that this species was alive at this location at that particular time. And it wasn't, it's dead, same as some of these other ones you can easily tag them.
Recording in progress.
Should I start again?
Not sure what's going on here.
Okay. Another annotation that you can add. There's a spot down here where it says evidence of presence. So these people did not actually see bears, but they had evidence that bears were present at that time. The same thing with the footprint. And you'll see that they did include their hand and their foot for scale. I used to always ask my husband for a quarter or a loonie so that whenever we went out exploring, and so I was getting rich very quickly, you know, dollar time. With pictures such as the hobble bush, you can also add, annotate them and add an attribute on the plant phenology. So you can say that this plant was flowering. You have the choices of that the flower was budding, flowering, fruiting, or that there was no evidence of flowering.
Not sure if you saw, there's a chat comment there asking if in the bear scat, if you could add an identification of the seeds in the scat.
I think you probably could, but I think that you would have to maybe put a little square around the seeds, or at least make a comment in the notes box to say that that's what you were looking at. But yeah.
I know, like in my case, I've sometimes made two postings because you had two different things in the same photograph. And so I just post the same photograph with two different identifications and make the note as to what I'm referring to.
Yes, and that's relatively easy to do. You can upload your observation, then you can say duplicate it. It's pretty good. But I think I would tend to edit my picture, maybe put a circle around it, so that the person knows exactly what you're looking at. Does that make sense? Sometimes when there's multiple things in a picture, you don't really know, are they looking at the plants here or the scat or the trees, these sorts of things. So there should be one picture that is really cropped and it's obvious what you want to have identified. So here's the plant phenology. You cannot add multiple ones from here. So you can say it's flowering, would that be fruiting when it's as the seeds? Got to put pictures of dandelions up here. This is starting to look at content in iNaturalist from Nova Scotia of plants. So I did a little filtering in here. So if you go directly to the iNaturalist.ca site, there's a place where you can click explore. You can enter a species name in here and it will filter out the observations and try to search for those. If you type a location name in here, if I typed in Nova Scotia, you'd get the page would zoom into the Nova Scotia, but you could zoom in, zoom out. And if you did that, you could click redo search and map and it would refresh the content. I tend to click on this button for filters and there's a place in there where I can choose the place name Nova Scotia and it has a defined boundary as opposed to a general latitude longitude box. And you'll notice that when you do click on explore, the URL that's at the top includes a number of fields down here. So this place ID is Nova Scotia. I want to see a map and I'm looking for plants.
So your internet connection is unstable.
I'm fine. Are you guys okay?
I'm seeing it okay.
I'm seeing it okay.
So this is the box that you would see if you clicked on this filter. So you can go through and say, I only want to see wild species. I want to see captive. I want to see who's been posting pictures of their cats or of their marigolds or of their indoor plants. Or I want to see species that are threatened, various things. So lots of choices. You can click on plants, mushrooms, birds, spiders, different things. You could say, I only want to see the pictures that Mary McCauley has been posting. So I could put in her username in here because I know what it is. And I could click on plants and I could go through here and say, I want to see what she collect it in the month of February or January, and that would show up. So there's lots of options here on how to filter your observations. And I don't know if you can see that link that's right down at the bottom, but it was just basically, I could also do it, same thing, choosing the month, the place name, and observations associated with David Corcadell.
Huh?
You okay? Can
you
go to the bathroom?
Yeah, you forget what you do with the stuff. Is the water still there?
Yeah, I think Sheila, could you mute?
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I thought I was muted.
Yeah. So I decided that it would be great to have a project for the Wild Flora Society, but I didn't feel that I had the rights or the ability to create one. And I wasn't sure you wanted to have a project that had the word society in it. So several years ago, I created one. It was just called Nova Scotia Wild Flora. And I just set it to plants that were wild within Nova Scotia. And so this is, you can see down here, I said I wanted plants. I chose an area of Nova Scotia. I didn't include or exclude anybody. I could have decided to exclude myself. I said I want research grade or needs ID observations. I did not want any casual observations. That would mean ones that plants were cultivated or observations that didn't have a photo included with them. And I said any kind of establishment. I didn't care about date. And I set myself up to be the administrator. So this is how you would set up a project. One of the reasons that you would want to create a project is because you want to share information to the community. If you're just filtering observations, there are other ways to do that. And one of the things that we tried a few years ago was creating a journal post to highlight one of the field trips done by the group. And so it just had a general introduction about the trip that you had down to Digby Neck with the dates. It listed the species that you were looking for on that trip. And then it had a couple of links. This first link was to view observations that people posted during the trip. And the second was just to view observations found in that area in the past. And it wasn't filtered for date and time. So it's just an example of what you can do. You can also use iNaturalist and create a post to highlight local species. So in the past, you guys have gone out to look for hobblebush and you've posted pictures of it. You can also go to iNaturalist and say, I want to see all the observations of hobblebush that others have posted. And I put in here them during the months of March and April. And these are just a few of the observations. And you can also browse content on iNaturalist to maybe solve that question of which plant comes first. Is it going to be a skunk cabbage or is it going to be, what was the other one you were mentioning? The mistletoe. So maybe there are other people in other parts of the province that will get out there over the next few weeks and start posting pictures. And maybe you can authoritatively say which one comes first. The other thing about tracking species over time is that we can encourage people all around the province to get out there and show signs of spring or show signs of fall and changes in the seasons. And many years ago, I think there's a lot of publicity given to this Alexander McKay Students Project. This was the one where the school superintendent back in the early 1900s made all school children report on signs of spring in Nova Scotia. So there were all these massive books that contain all the records of when they first saw dandelion flower, first pussy willow, when they saw geese flying south and stuff. So I've set up a similar iNaturalist project to just track some of the species that were listed in these books. There's also the late bloomers in Nova Scotia. I think this is for plants, not for people, but it's it was one set up by David to try to see which flowers are still around after Nova, November 1st in Nova Scotia. You could ask the question, when does the hobble bush flower in Nova Scotia? When does it start? And probably skipped over something here, but if you click on the name hobble bush, maybe up here, it will open up a new page in iNaturalist that gives you lots of information about the particular species. And it also includes a number of graphs on the side. Now you have to remember that these graphs are based on the content that people have posted. So the more observations you add, the better the graphs will be. You may find that for a lot of species, there are not a lot of observations in winter months because people aren't going out at that time. The gray line here is the number of observations of this particular species. The red lines would be on the different phenology. And you can see that very few people have actually clicked on assign these attributes. So it would be great if people could go through and say, yeah, that one's flowering, and then this line will come up and up. You can also, if you like programming, create some fancy URLs to pull this information out. Recently on your webpage, I've noticed that there's been talk about the proposed development here in Dartmouth up in Eisner's Cove wetlands. So I was interested to see what species were in that area, because they were talking about doing a number of bioblitzes. And so this is the area of the wetlands. And you can see that this is the name of the area. This is the number of observations that are currently posted from that area. And it's of 130 species. And there are a number of identifiers, and there were 18 people that have been posting. Now, these are some of the observations that have been posted recently. So if these were identified, maybe there would be more species. Or maybe this group can help with suggesting ways to improve observations so that it's obvious what the subject of the picture is. And it's also useful to, instead of assigning this as unknown, to say it's plant, or maybe this one is a woodpecker. I'm not sure what the subject of the picture was.
Mary?
Yeah.
Can I just make a comment about that particular project? Because yeah. I'm fairly familiar with it. I'm the one who set up that particular project, so to collect these things. And what happened was the group there, you know, this whole issue came up very quickly. And they decided that they needed to look for species at risk in the middle of winter. And I tried to explain to them the limitations of that. But anyway, regardless, they went ahead, and really it was a remarkable show of people's interest in the area. But what they did the first week, they just went out and they would take a picture of a tree trunk, and that would be the only picture. So I immediately emailed them this and that, said, look, you got to take a few more pictures, and so on and so forth. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make is that that's been a little bit of a learning process for the people were very enthusiastic, but it has been a learning process on what to do. So I actually posted a page somewhere of like kinds of things you should look at. And I just like to say that one thing that I'd really like to see people do, you may or may not agree with this, but I really think it's important to always include a habitat shot.
Yeah, no,
because,
I agree.
Because to me, that just adds a lot more information. You know, you're going into a site, and if all you're seeing is a picture of a tree trunk, it doesn't tell you much. But if there's a picture of the habitat, that adds kind of another level of information, which I think, like in this case in particular, would be really valuable. So I'm just commenting in general on that particular project. So they're learning. And they're very, very keen. And now, you know, they're doing their own workshops and everything else. But the reason you have so many unknowns that first time, I mean, most people, based on what they posted, you really couldn't identify what it was, because, you know, it's very hard to identify most trees just from one picture of the trunk.
Yeah, and I expect that it will improve. I think they're going to have several more.
It's improving over time. Yeah.
Yep. And I don't live very far away from here, from there. And if you actually looked at those observations, you'll see that I probably have 90% of them. So I've been there many times because it's great, but I do find that I always get my feet wet. Because there is a little stream that runs through here that wet. You don't really notice until too late.
It's mucky, yeah.
Yeah, no, it's not mucky, it's wet.
Yeah.
But it is a great area. And I think this is one of the things for the City Nature Challenge is that there are a lot of these little areas that we may not know about in our backyards. And so can we find them? Can we go out and explore them? And then can we use this knowledge later on when there are specific reasons why we want to show what species exist in this area? So I'd like to cut you off.
No, go ahead. I'm Tara, and I'm involved with the Eisner Cove Wetland group. So really, I'm here on your contact. So I'm just really happy to learn more about this and share it with the group of citizens who are very, very keen. David, thank you. I really have appreciated all of your tips too. So we're all learning, and this is going to be really great information that I'll share with our group. And I'm really happy to now be acquainted with the Wild Flora Society, and I'll hopefully join in on more of these get-togethers and meet some of you. But yes, just thank you.
Yeah, a new member, right? One of the things that I think David was mentioning is that you don't have to just post one picture, but when you do share multiple pictures, the first one is the one that iNaturalist software is going to use to try to suggest the name. So put your best picture first, because you can reorder the images. Just because you took one before the other, you don't have to have them in that order. And also maybe crop that picture so it's easy to see that it's the bear, not the tree that you're interested in, or things along that line. But it is good. We did a little review of maple trees earlier this winter and had a look at some of them. And it's very difficult sometimes to identify something from just a leaf. So we're trying to encourage people to include branches and then include one from further away of the entire tree. If you're looking at a lichen, you know, it's important to know, is that lichen growing on a tree? Is it on the ground? Where, you know, what's the substrate? You also need to know, there's lots of different views that you can include and should include. And I'm hoping that's one of the outcomes from this meeting, is that there will be a desire to jot down a few notes. If you are looking at certain species, these are the views that you should include. And if you did, then maybe other people could help identify them. So this is where
Can I just make one more comment about that?
You can make all kinds of comments.
Yeah, the other side of the coin is that, it does cost money for them to store all these images. So that, I'm quite selective what images I put up. And the other thing is that it's good if you every now and then they have a campaign to raise some money for iNaturalist. But I think if we're putting lots of pictures on, even if we just contribute $5 or something, that can be a big help, I think, to maintaining this database.
This is the link for, if I clicked on the species from the previous page in here, if I click on this one is showing the maps here. If I click on this list, then you'll come to this page and it shows you the species that have been observed in the area. Originally, I did this as a square box. That's why it has this Latin long in here. I didn't realize that there was an area definition for the Eisner Cove, but you see that the number one species that has been posted is tamarack, and that there are 11 observations of tamarack, and that there are only 9 observations of pitcher plant. And it's likely that these pictures are of scat and not really of deer, but who knows? And you can sort of see it's relatively interesting. There's very few dandelions or coltsfoot in this data set. If you were to click on this observations, it would open up the page that shows you the observations and the individual photos that people had shared. If you click on the word tamarack, it is going to pop open to an information page on that species. And I believe that I've showed for here, I clicked on sheep laurel and then it opens up this particular page and it will show you a number of different pretty pictures. You can flip through here if you want to keep looking at the different ones. You'll see that the top observer of sheep laurel in this particular area is me. The number one identifier of it is Burkhard. And you'll probably see his name for most of the species in the Halifax area. This is where you can see the seasonality. And it's not necessarily that this is when these plants are visible. It's probably just could be tracked to the number of times that we went to go visit the area. We went more often in July than we did in January. The about section on here gives you all kinds of information from Wikipedia. And this goes down quite far. If you clicked on taxonomy, it would give you all the information, kingdom, phyla, class, order, all that sort of stuff. You could give you information here on the conservation status, and it might under here tell you similar species so you could learn a little bit more. This was at one point we were trying to suggest that maybe the Facebook pages could be a way to entice new people to join the Wild Forest Society and try to engage them. And so I was trying to encourage originally people such as Jeff to put his pictures on iNaturalist and then take that URL, put that in Facebook and then write a short discussion about it. And I think that this method works quite well. I mean, you're putting pictures on iNaturalist. You don't need to upload the same pictures to Facebook. You can simply put the URL in there. It has the date, the time, location, has more information. And then you can try to stimulate conversation. This may or may not work, but it's just another idea. One of the projects that I set up a couple of years ago, and I quite like it. It's kind of probably a fluffier type of project, but I had gone out to the deanery, which is in Lower Ship Harbor, and I don't know if many of you have had the opportunity to get out there, but it's a very interesting location. And the person at the time was very upset by this book called The Lost Words, and it is a child's book that has pictures of words that were taken out of the children's dictionary to make room for words about technology. So it could be that something like ivy was taken out to include a word like blog or Wi-Fi or internet. And so there are all these different words. So I created this project that filtered for the words that were in this book. And I thought it would be kind of neat because the kids can't learn what the about the word because it's not in the dictionary. So they have to use technology to learn about the species. It's not in the book. So I thought it was kind of circular. I also found out that somebody in Texas had created a very similar project. This is coming back to the BC Parks project. And you can sort of see that they have almost 500,000 observations being posted of species. They are doing a fantastic job. And they have all kinds of guides and manuals and handbooks, and they have all kinds of activities and bingo games and scavenger hunts, and they're doing a lot of work. So we'd like to promote something similar here in Nova Scotia and benefit from their success. So we've gone through and added all the area definitions for all the provincial parks in Nova Scotia. I think there's probably only about 200 and some. And iNaturalist has now limited the number of place names you could add in a 24-hour period. That's 3. So I think it took me about 2.5 weeks to upload all of these areas. But now that they're there, if anyone goes out to a park and you post a picture or an observation, it will automatically be added to this project. You won't even know it exists. But we can now start adding articles to this project journal and share more information. So my hope is that people will set lots of personal goals for 2022 to share passion for wildlife, wild flora, and of course, come out and participate in the City Nature Challenge. This is just a 4-day event. So if we can get people out, the statistics that are tracked are the number of participants. So if you convince someone else to come out and they post one observation, that's one more on that particular stat. If you, it counts the number of observations. So if you posted a picture of a dandelion in 10 different locations, that's good. Don't post 10 dandelions from the exact spot in your yard, but make sure that they're different. And of course, if we can get more species, that would be so much better. So if you set yourself a challenge to try to post not just the common everyday species, but ones that you have to go and actually look for. It should be very easy to post 50 species.
How do you define the word city?
Very loosely. We chose, for Halifax area, we chose all of HRM. So the entire municipality all the way up, you know, past Sheet Harbour and also Sable Island. So if you know anyone out there. For the Valley area, we chose Kings and Annapolis counties, the entire area. CBRM is the large area as well. So it's really depends on what you wanted to define as your city. They really just track the statistics that you post, number of observations, but there is a way that they can go through and they can calculate this dependent upon the area, because we have to provide the square kilometers of our area definition and also what the population size is, but nobody really looks at those stats. So we are competing against Calgary, against Toronto, and we really want to beat Calgary. At least I do. And I really would like to beat Toronto. So this is, there's lots of stats here, lots of pretty pictures. So this year, the City Nature Challenge runs Friday through to a Monday. So you have the ability to get school age kids contributing as part of their classes. And you also have people that can get out on the weekends as families or go out individually. With COVID, we didn't organize any official group events, simply encourage people to get out on their own or get out in their bubbles. And I think that's really part of enjoying nature for me, is to train people before this big event and then let them go explore. So these are the top 10 species that were posted in the Maritimes. And it was coltsfoot that won, but it was also, it's April. It's really nice to see a little yellow flower out there. The next one was Mayflower. And I think that is great, being our provincial flower, that it beat out dandelions. So and anytime I go out exploring, I always try to find a Mayflower and share it. And you see the paper birch, sheep laurel for wintergreen, Mayflower, and then robins. So the plants are certainly winning in all of this. And this year, there are 385 cities around the world that have registered to participate. And in Canada, there are 43 entries. So to help coordinate all these entries, there's a small group of us that are trying to reduce duplication of effort. So we're trying to trying to work together. So if something is good for people in Halifax or the Maritimes, maybe it's good for people in BC or Regina or Winnipeg. So we're just trying to share ideas and highlight Canadian biodiversity. So this is our page at the moment. We did get Newfoundland to join this year. In the past, we haven't bothered to, I haven't bothered to reach out to them and pester them to join, because I think there was one year that the week of the City Nature Challenge was probably that week that everyone was talking about the moose that were on the roofs of the houses in St. John's, because there was so much snow over there. So, but this year they have signed up. So you can see it. There's a fair number of places in New Brunswick and the three in Nova Scotia, two in PEI of Charlottetown and Summerside, and then St. John's. So we're hoping as the City Nature Challenge starts, the numbers start trickling in, and you'll see these numbers going up and down on this leaderboard. And you can also access the global leaderboard. And it's always really interesting, because this challenge starts at 1 second after midnight your local time. So it means that if you were to look at this in the Thursday evening, you'll see that New Zealand has come online, you know, and they're doing great because, you know, they're right at the top of the leaderboard until the sun comes up in Europe and then Africa. And then all of a sudden, you know, New Zealand's way down at the bottom, but then it gets, then the North America comes online and then it gets to be nighttime. And then you see, you know, New Zealand try to catch up again. So it's fun watching the changes in the leaderboard. But as I say, with COVID, it's less of a competitive challenge. It's more of a collaborative event. So I was trying to come up with a couple of challenges if we want to encourage people to get out and look for specific things during this year's City Nature Challenge. And Sean Hoyen suggested that they could look for 5 common lichen. So here are a couple. So maybe you could find many different species of cladonia or several kinds of beard lichens. So it's not difficult to get a lot of species. You just have to just set a goal. Now, if people are ready, I can give you a promo video. This is a picture of a little girl from Cape Breton. So here is our, let's see if I can make this work. This is a promo video from 2021. The one for this year is not out yet. I'll share that when it is available.
Welcome to the 2021 City Nature Challenge. Now more than ever, we need to study nature in cities around the globe. We can't fully protect nature on this planet without studying what is living in cities. Help us by joining the over 350 cities worldwide, as some compete and some collaborate to see how many wildlife observations we can gather together. Using cameras and smartphones, tens of thousands of people will take pictures or record sounds of wildlife in their home cities, all contributing to an international database of urban wildlife that will be used by scientists and naturalists to help understand nature in our cities and work to make them better places for humans and wildlife to live. Just imagine how many observations we can make, all working together. Go to citynaturechallenge.org to see if you're in one of the cities taking part between April 30th and May 3rd. Then take pictures of wildlife and upload them to our global database using iNaturalist or your city's preferred platform. Watch as experts all over the world help to identify your observations. Join the 2021 City Nature Challenge or follow along and see how we work together to change the world.
We weren't able to see the video there, Mary, just hear the audio. Yeah.
Well, I quite enjoyed it.
We didn't hear it.
Okay, well, I can send you the link again.
I think it has to do with share screen. You have to select a different window and things.
Okay. Oh, well, I blew that one. I'll see if I can get back to my other presentation here. That was a very nice one. There. So you can see the picture here. Okay.
Yes.
All right. So this is where we can break into doing a little bit of hands-on. Say, I think there's a lot of information on about iNaturalist on island online. You know, asked if you want more information about what it is or who's behind it and all that sort of stuff. I really like the video tutorial section here, and I don't know how to do that because that would be another link to. So how would you like to proceed at this point? Do people have many questions or to me, the advantage of getting people out and participating in this four-day challenge, aside from the fact that it's fun, and is that it gets people trained very easy early in the season. So if there are bigger bioblitzes happening throughout the season, whether it's the treasured wetlands, or whether it's the Nature Conservancy Canada big backyard blitzes, or whether it's National Moth Week, or whether it's a, there's so many, people are trained and they're willing to come out and play.
So in order to register for the BioBlitz, the City Nature Challenge, how does one do that?
You don't really have to do anything. You just have to go out and post your pictures to iNaturalist. They will automatically be included. The advantage of joining a project, and I can share the one that we've set up for the Maritimes, is that if somebody posts a journal article, you'll automatically be notified. So it's there's no other reason why you would join a project unless you want to be notified when there are changes to that particular project. Because most of these projects, if you fit the criteria, if you have the right species from the right location at the right time, and somebody hasn't said, hey, it's for members only, then your observations will automatically be added.
Mary McCauley here. I think people should know, because it took me a long time to figure this out, is that the maritime lichens, you actually have to go and add that one. That one doesn't automatically upload your lichen to it.
There are a number, yes. I think that when you look at a project, you can go up and you can say you want to join, and it usually tells you the if there are any restrictions. If you are going with some of the older projects, such I think as the Maritime Lichen, because I think they want you to add different observation fields. I think you have to do a little bit of extra work if you're going to share your observations with them. One example is there is the Watch for Wildlife has a project page, and I think your observations are automatically added to it by somebody. If they will go and they look at all the pictures of raccoons, if your raccoon looks like it was on a road, they will manually add your observation to their project.
Yeah, there are some projects that automatically you're added. For the lichen project, you actually have to click. You just have to put a check mark on your observation. So there's a couple of other projects that are like that.
One would be the ACC, DC, the Sean Blaney's rare species of Nova Scotia. You have actually join that project.
Yeah, you have to join it. But that I joined the lichen project. The rare species one, no, they seem to upload them. You don't have to click anything. But I think maybe David can speak to this. I think maybe like the moose project and the hemlock project, I think you might have to actually click on those ones as well.
I can say that I know that you have to join the rare species one, because they want you to actually agree that they can use your observation. Because rare species, the true location of Latin long is obscured. So it's not public, but by you joining their project, you agree that you will share with them the true latitude and longitude for your coordinates.
Yes, but once you've agreed, if you find a rare species, it does automatically put that rare species in there.
Right.
Anyway, just.
Would it be useful if we went online and tried to have a look at your moose projects, or share screen?
Oops, sorry, if anybody wants to share screen and see something, it should work. Just need to select, I think Mary, if you maybe shut down your share screen. If,
sure. And one other thing I'll say right now is that when you do sign up for iNaturalist, you create your own profile, you assign yourself a username. And I would suggest that you take a little bit of thought before you choose your name, because I think I've seen ones that are really kind of weird. And these are the names that get assigned to your observation and are shared internationally. So, you know, you don't want anything that's too fluffy out there. The other thing is, when under your profile, you can choose what language you wish to view iNaturalist in. iNat has 40 different languages, so it's a great tool for people whose first language might not be English or French. But try to, over the last couple of years, I've been working to see if I can add common names for species in Mi'kmaq. And this is possible. It is just taking a fair bit of work, but that's something that I'm used to working with species names and can work with orthographies. And so we probably have about 40 or so names in there at the moment under Mi'kmaq, and also a few under Gaelic, because that seemed like it might be easier to add than Mi'kmaq names, but it too is taking time.
So Mary, where can we see those Mi'kmaq names?
It's something that only you are going to see. You're not going to be able to share it with other people. But okay. when you go to, I'm trying to figure out how to unshare my screen here.
What you need to do, Mary, if you click on the share screen, it should bring up a thing that allows you to select which
windows share. Stop share. Okay. Yeah. When you go to iNaturalist and under your profile, you say what kind of common names you want to use. You can say, I want the ones associated with Canada, I want the ones associated with England, or I want the ones from Australia. There's a spot in there that you can say, I want to use the common names associated with Unimagi. And I chose Unimagi in Cape Breton just because it was simpler to do, and I couldn't find a proper definition for Mi'kma'ki at the time. So that it was sort of an interim thing, just hasn't been changed. So if you do that, then the common name shows up, will be in Mi'kmaq. So it's cool. Just many things that you can do. So can I get to the internet from here? Or Bob, can you do that? Or
If you want to try it on your end first, if you select share screen, it should give you a choice of all the screen. Like if you do the top left one, it says screen there. It should give you all of the windows on your computer.
Okay.
And then if you open up your browser, we should be able to see it. Yeah, that's got it.
Okay, can you see that?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. All right. So if I went down to, it says all the information in here. If I go down here to help, and then if I went to video tutorials, I'll walk you through here how to add an observation via the web. Can you see that?
Yep.
You can make a valuable contribution to conservation with photos or sound recordings that you've taken with a mobile device or digital camera. Every photo is a record of a living thing that can be used to quantify biodiversity, track invasive species, locate species at risk, and much more. And it's never too late. Even old photos, if you can remember where they were taken, provide valuable information. Using a web uploader, you can upload, combine, and batch edit photos and sounds, then submit them to iNaturalist. Here's how to do it. Head to iNaturalist.ca and create an account or log in to an existing account. To get to the uploader, click on the green uploader button in the header, and from here, drag and drop the files you want to add or choose from the menu. Once you've dragged in your photos and sounds, iNaturalist will import each one as a card in the workspace here. Keep in mind, the photos have not been added as observations in iNaturalist just yet. That won't happen until you hit the green submit button in the upper right-hand corner. We recommend not adding more than about 50 files at a time into the uploaded page. Now that your observation cards are all in your workspace, you can start editing their information. You can edit a single observation by clicking on it here and entering the information directly on the card or in this area on the left-hand side. You'll see that geoprivacy, captive cultivated, tags, projects, and observation fields are all on the left-hand side as well. For geoprivacy, open will allow others on iNaturalist to see the location. Obscured will randomly buffer the true location, or private will ensure that it doesn't show up on any maps. To add an identification, click on the species name field, and iNaturalist will suggest visually similar species. Or you can type in a common or scientific name and choose from the drop-down menu. There's no sound recording software on iNaturalist, so you'll have to type in the species name. To add or edit location information, click on the location space here. You'll see that a location editor pops up, and you can type a place into the search bar at the top. Note that this will not search iNaturalist curated places. Rather, it's a Google Maps name search. And from here, you can pick a point and drag these control dots on the circle to show the accuracy level of your location. Once you're done, click on Update Observation to get back to your workspace. If you often make observations at the same location, such as a local park or your backyard, you can save it to your account as a pinned location. Once you have the correct coordinates, accuracy, geoprivacy settings, and notes in these fields, click on the pin button. Location will be saved. You can access it by clicking on your pinned location right here. Now, these two photos are the same organism, so you would want to combine them into one observation. You can either select them both and click Combine up at the top, or drag one card onto the other, and there you go. They've been merged into one. The date was stored in the photo's property, which iNaturalist has read. And if the photo was taken with a mobile device or digital camera with a built-in GPS, the location will also be automatically added. If not, check the location services on your device. These locations will not have an accuracy though, so it is very important to manually add that in. Otherwise, we can't know if you are at the observation or perhaps several hundred meters away. Finally, let's say you want to batch edit your cards. You can select certain cards with your mouse or click Select All at the top. Once you've selected all the observations you'd like to edit, you can use the forms on the left-hand side to do so. Anything you enter on the left-hand side will affect all the cards you have selected. Now that you've edited everything you want to, you just have to hit submit and will be added to your account and the iNaturalist database. Now that you know how to add observations online, have a look through old photos to see what you can dig up. If you're ready to head outside and get new photos, consider using the free iNaturalist mobile app. Get to know what's living around you. Join iNaturalist Canada today.
So that was just a brief introduction. And there's a similar video if you want to watch on how to upload using the your mobile device. Do others have questions or ideas of how they use iNaturalist?
There's a new app, I think it's called Seek or something. Are you familiar with that?
I think it's more for kids, or it's something that you can use when you're out in the field. The data's not saved as far as I know. So it's a way that you can go out, you can use it. It's run by iNaturalist, so you can go out, uses the same software. But the problem with iNaturalist is that you must be 13 in order to have an account, because you know you don't want young kids sharing information online. So that's what OiSeek was developed, I believe.
Mary, it's Ann Mills here. I learned about Seek in 2020. Eric and I were away just before COVID really hit in Texas on a birding trip. And one of the leaders suggested to me when I was looking at plants and also looking at mosses and so on. And he said, well, have you tried Seek? And I said, no, what is it? And he said, well, it's free and it's part of iNat, but it's something that you can just take a photo and it can help you right away to get an identification. It's very quick. It's useful when you're out birding, say, and your focus isn't on plants, but you kind of wonder what that is. They do keep your data. I have a list that I have accumulated here in Nova Scotia. It's not very long. And it will, once the plant is identified, it goes into a bank, and then I can access it anytime I want to review what plants I've seen, or I couldn't remember what this little, whatever it is. I've seen it again, and I thought, oh, what is that? So then I go back to my list, and there it is. So it's very useful to me because my focus is mosses, not vascular plants. And it used to be vascular plants all the time, but I've been overtaken by these mosses.
Yep.
And to get into mosses, that requires microscope work in many cases. You know, the look at the inside of a leaf, or the what's in the arrangement of cells in a cross section of the stem, etc. And or how many teeth they have in the sporophyte capsule. And so I have so much to do with that, and I just can't see myself wedding myself to iNat as well. And I know it's the diversity and accumulation of important plants and animals and insects, other vertebrates and so on. But it's just, for me, it's just too much work to do something. And I would be mostly focusing on bryophytes.
Yeah, and I'm not sure, because I haven't really used Seek. I assume that the app would give you the same answers if you tried that out in the field, but I haven't. Has anybody else used?
Yes.
I've used it a lot. I went out west to the Okanagan. It's Doug here. And I found it great. It was my son, Will, who's an iNat champion, who told me about Seek. I was traveling with him, and I was using it to identify all these shrubs and the things that were totally unfamiliar. The thing about Seek that is nicer than iNat is that it's immediate. You don't have to upload it and then wait for the metadata to load. You just take a picture, and if enough information is there in the photograph, it will provide you with an ID right there without having to go into iNat.
But won't iNat do that as well if you take a picture?
It's just quicker. It's just quicker and easier.
Okay.
It also kind of, I've suggested it for people learning to use iNaturalist, because it kind of forces you to take a good picture. It'll tell you if the first picture is not informative enough to identify it, it asks you to take another picture. So I learned that from Anne. So I think it's a good way to learn how to take pictures for iNaturalist.
Right. And maybe it's something for one of these journal articles. You know, if we know that if you're taking pictures of ferns, that there are certain features that you need to include. So, you know, maybe there's things for moss. And I think it's one of the things that we've discussed a little bit before about iNat just puts a lot of emphasis on trying to get down to species level. But I think that for many of our species, we can only get down to genus or maybe higher. So if we can help people get to genus level, I think that's fantastic.
Mm.
Yeah.
I have used Seek too. This is Ron. And I find it very helpful most of the time, but but it's not identical to iNat. It's based upon it, but it's not always as up to date as iNaturalist. So as iNaturalist gets more and more refined, Seek can be a little bit behind. But overall, it's very good, and they're very similar. And you get the same results, but not 100% of the time.
Yeah, I think that one of the things about adding more observations to iNaturalist is that the first photo is the auto recognition algorithm, but it also looks at what other people have posted in the area. So if nobody has been out around, Tatamagush and been posting things, then iNat won't know that the most common species in that area are certain things. So the more that are posted, the better it gets. And that's why, you want to post the same species in every single, park and trail that you go on every couple of kilometers. Now, I don't think it's necessary to post every rugosa rose that you see as you're walking on a trail, but maybe one every couple of kilometers might be good. But you can't really judge how someone else is connecting with nature. So it's a, you can filter out or group, aggregate.
I have a couple of questions, Mary. Ron again. About species, about posting the same species over and over again. I don't have a problem with birds because they move, so you don't know if it's the same one or not. But if you're on the trail and you've been on that trail last month and the month before that and before that, and do you?
Yes, because it's a different time. And I think that it's the rules are basically one individual, one day, one time, whatever. But as far as I'm concerned, if there's more than 4 hours in between when you saw a species and when it showed up again, maybe it's a different observation. And this could be more relevant for people that have trail cameras, and you see some bobcat that's been hanging around for several hours and then it disappears and comes back again. But I think there's probably many people who for different reasons post observations of the same species at the same location. But iNat says it's supposed to be of an individual. So if I go to Shubi Park, I could take pictures of every single, mallard duck that's there because they're all different. But normally what I would do is I'd go and say that there were 5 male and, 17 female or something. But if you look at all those ducks, they are all different.
Yeah, but what I'm wondering is, let's say I've been on one particular trail and I take a picture of, a pine tree.
Yep.
Next time I go to the same trail.
And it's still there.
The tree is still there.
Yeah, well,
I don't remember which one I took a picture of.
Yeah, well, you might make Mary happy. But I think what you can do and things like that, I have a giant maple tree out front. And, I could take a picture of it every couple of months or maybe every couple of weeks when things start to change. And that might show seasonal variations in the plant. So it might show, okay, the first time I started to see a bud coming out on that particular tree was on, April 15th, it was in flower, then whatever time and then all those sorts of things. So it's how you wish to connect. Now, if I was taking a picture of a particular tree on a trail, maybe there's birds on that tree, or maybe it's infested with some sort of pest or something like that. So there could be reasons why you might include the same tree again, I would limit the same obvious feature.
I have another question along the same line, which is sort of proper iNat etiquette, I guess, of you've got several people on a field trip, you all find this rare species and everybody takes a picture of it.
And that's fine, but that's fine because you are contributing to your own life list. So, yeah. And that was my original question when I, my very first iNat BioBlitz, it was up in Ignish, it was part of the Canada 150. And we were all standing in the same patch of goldenrod, taking pictures of the same bumblebee. And then we moved 100 feet down the way and took pictures of the same dragonfly. I didn't get it, but what happens to that group of 20, we all went off in different directions. but I still have on my life list, it shows that I saw a particular kind of bumblebee in Cape Breton in a location I probably won't go back to. So it is useful. And but if you are sending a group of kids or going out and they're taking pictures of a dandelion, and I'm just using that as an example, they must be able to find a different dandelion somewhere in that schoolyard that they could take a different picture, you know. So it's but if you find the one and only species, everyone wants to have that skunk cabbage that's flowering, you know. So there's nothing wrong with that. And I think there's so many observations in iNaturalist, it all forms a good picture. And as I share pictures of anything, I quite often get bored when we're out wandering around and Don's society wants to stop and talk to someone. So I'll switch from taking pictures of birds to trees to crickets or whatever happens to be there. And I was contacted a couple of years ago by somebody because we had been at Point Pelee, and he said, my observation was the southernmost point for a particular species of crickets in Canada. Of course, I was on the southernmost part of Canada. So any observation I posted would have fit that criteria. So just whatever you want to post. And I know that that you can filter your observations, Bob. So I know that you weren't overly thrilled the first year we did the City Nature Challenge because your observations were more of rare species or unique species in different spots. And, you know, to post pictures of daisies and buttercups and, you know, knotweed and all that sort of stuff wasn't particularly, what you wanted to focus on, but you can filter them out.
Yeah, I think as I've come to learn iNaturalist more, I realized, like originally I was trying to make sure that everything that was on iNaturalist was the best representation of one species and it wasn't getting all cluttered up, right? But then I realized that it's just too big, like there's just too much stuff and you have to, like you can't curate it that way.
And there's no need to curate it that way. And, when we were going down around the Digby or Valley a while ago, I saw this woodpecker go flying away. And of course my picture is this little tiny dot, but I knew it was a woodpecker. So I posted my photo and it's just a little tiny dot. There's no way that anybody's going to be able to identify it. So it's just going to sit there forever as that, but it's part of my list. I know that when we were out there, we did see this one particular bird, and maybe the next time I go back, I'll be able to find it again. So there's always room for improvement. And I think the feedback we get from other people does help. And my classic example was, I started taking pictures of mushrooms a few years ago and I was so thrilled because they were actually in focus for a change, you know, but nobody would identify them. So what's wrong with them? And so, well, you only took a picture of the cap. Okay. So then they said, you have to take pictures of the gills. So I went out and took pictures of the cap and the gills. Well, now you need pictures of the stem. So it took me a little while because I kind of refused to take out the guidebook, but I did improve over time. There's still a lot of them that aren't being identified, but so it's training people to combine your electronic device with the book, because you do have to use the book or someone has to use the book. So. Yeah, Kevin's talking. Can't hear you, Kevin. Yeah, and I think that in the chat, Dave McCorkendale said, if you connect observations of the same plant in October, November, December, March, April, May, that you document the phenology. So and so you can see that the growth over time. And one of the, if you are taking pictures of the same plant and you know exactly where it is, then if your first couple of observations weren't great, you can ask somebody else, can you go back and find that tree again? Can you include a few more pictures so I can tell what kind of maple tree it is? And then because you know it's the same one, you can add a little note. This is the same tree as seen in another observation. And then somebody else might be able to identify it for you. No, it's this is, there was a question about multiple observers, like on eBird, where you get to share lists. I don't think there's any easy way to do that. I think that, but it's not that complicated. Like if you have your same, I think you'd want to have different pictures though, Kevin. I think you'd have to take your pictures and I'd have to take mine and then upload those. But it's very easy to upload 50 pictures or so at a time. Now, as I say, I use the online method versus the app, but if I did go out and if I did record a lot of pictures on my phone, when I would come home, I would probably dump those onto my laptop and upload it that way. It's just the way that I have been doing it rather than uploading one at a time.
Mary, the way I understand iNat is as time goes on, somebody identifies, if you don't know or they agree with your identification, whatever, and that's overall, it improves things. But every once in a while, what I've noticed is somebody, probably somebody who has very little experience, posts an ID, says the ID on this is wrong, it's something else. And that sort of throws it back to the beginning.
Yes, and that's true. So what happens is that in order to get your research grade, the community has to agree with the name. And so if I posted something, I had no idea what it was, and then somebody that I kind of trust goes along and signs the name, I can click agree, but I should really make sure that they're correct and that I do agree with them, because maybe they typed it in wrong. Maybe that little autocorrect got in there, or just because they're an expert in birds might not mean that they're an expert in periwinkles or something along that line. So you do have to kind of look at these things. And sometimes some people go and they look at the profile of the person who was identifying it. You know, are they a curator? Are they somebody who's in high school? You know, and you can make some sort of judgment values, but sometimes kids in high school are excellent identifiers. What happens is if I assigned it as a genus name, someone else said it was a species, and then someone else came along and pushed it back to the genus, it loses that research grade flag.
Yeah, I know, but I guess my question was more along the lines of, let's say you identify a species and you know what it is, and you identify it correctly, and I don't know, Kevin agrees with it, and three more people all agree with it, and the identification is correct, and then some, maybe a high school student comes along and says, no, this is a, and whatever.
Yeah. I think what you can do is that you can reach out and message that person and say, why'd you do that? And I think you might find that sometimes, one of the things I've been talking about, the stats, you know, the number of observations, number of species, number of participants, and I rarely talk about the number of identifiers, even though they are probably one of the most important components of this community. But you don't want to try to get somebody who's trying to up the number of species that they've identified. That's not a stat that you really want to promote, because that means that I might sit down and I might go through, you know, hundreds of observations today and just add a name so I can up my stat. You want that to be correct. And I think it's important for university projects that they don't put a lot of weight on trying to get students to identify things, because they might go, it might have been at the species level, but yet they can only identify it at the class or something. So they go and they identify it to the class, and now they've upset your observation. So I think that's where some of that error comes in.
Yeah, there seems to be some of that anyway, maybe not enough to make a huge difference, but there seems to be some. I've noticed some.
Yeah, and I sometimes reach out to somebody after a name has been changed, you know, I really want to find a lesser blackback gull, and I put that name on. Several people agree with me because they just want to agree with me. And then someone else goes, no, it's not, you know. And so then I have to go back to those other people and sort of say, I was wrong. You shouldn't have agreed with me. So say it takes community and it takes discussion, and if we work together, it will improve. It's not going away, so it will improve.
I mean, the good thing is that the evidence is there.
That's right. Yep.
So, you know, that's all that stays there. That's the really good thing about it. So a researcher who's, you know, relying on a species identification, go in and check the evidence themselves. So I think that's just kind of inevitable in that kind of, that's that sort of populist thing that you're going to have some of that. But
yeah.
It seems to work pretty well, I find.
Yeah. And I think it's a great tool. For many years, I used to look at the data sets being created by the Dallas Seaside courses. You know, they'd have the kids go out and collect a number of samples and bring them back to the lab. And then they'd go through and identify them. How many of these unidentified amphipod, unidentified, you know, mussel, unidentified snail, like, you know, that's a like zero value in for a data set. So I'd say like, if only you had a picture, you know, then maybe next year when the same class comes out and goes and collects the samples from the same area, they might be able to say, okay, I think it was a periwinkle, you know, and it would add value.
Mary, what's your thought on, there are various competitors, I guess you could say, to iNaturalist or local apps. Like there's the one Nature Tracker and PEI, there's the NOAA project. Well, you mentioned eBird earlier and various others.
But eBird and iNaturalist aren't in competition, they aren't. You know, they collect completely different things. And the important bit is that data is being collected and it's being shared. You know, it's not stuff that's being collected and left on my computer. It's not stuff that I'm putting on my Facebook page and it goes absolutely nowhere. Because you eBird requires a certain amount of expertise and you're creating checklists. You have to count the number of starlings that you saw. You know, I can't do that. I can't count. You have to record your the distance and your effort that you put in. So I'm relatively lazy and I'm not focused. So I prefer iNaturalist, but I use both. But I can understand that most birders don't want to go out with their camera, their binoculars, their mobile device, be tracking eBird and have to use iNaturalist. They're not, just not going to do it. But it doesn't matter.
I realize that, and like you, I prefer iNaturalist to eBird. But if someone has another reason, is there anything wrong with entering the same observation on two different platforms?
What I would do is I would write a note to say that I had shared it. So if you look at any of my eBird ones, you'll also see it says, I also shared this on iNaturalist. And on iNaturalist, I would include the eBird identifier. Now, a similar thing would be when you're going out and you're picking up a couple of ticks, when you're going out looking for plants, you can post pictures of those ticks on iNaturalist. Now, if you are interested, you can share those pictures of a tick with eTick, and they are interested for a completely different reason. They want to have a little more information about the tick and about you and your age and all those sorts of things. So you can share it. So you put that identifier in both. You say, you know, so that those programmers way down the road can figure out what it is. You can do the same thing for whales. If you see a, you know, nice humpback, you can post pictures on iNaturalist. And then you can share it with happywhale.org. And then you can track your whale as it's going around the world. But if you put the identifier and say that you shared it, then the world's happy. But it doesn't matter as long as the data is accessible for reuse. That's my bet.
So okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
Can I chime in on eBird and iNat, Mary?
Go for it.
Vermont? I have a little bit of experience on this. So when I go out birding, everything's on eBird. And eBird, the focus is on how many individuals you see given a unit of effort. So how much time and how many miles. Whereas iNaturalist, the focus is, does this organism, does this species occur here? So they're getting at different things, but as you can see behind me, I do take a lot of photos of Iceland gulls. And so when I do that, I put all my Iceland gulls on iNaturalist, but I also put a link to the eBird list that they're on for each one. And so therefore that allows people to see what the connection is between the two. But from my point of view, eBird and iNaturalist are getting at different things. eBird is looking at numbers, and iNaturalist is not, it's very good on lots of things, but it's not set up to look at numbers of individuals. You can put notes in there, but that's not what the focus is.
And I think there are a few other programs. I haven't looked too closely at the monarch butterfly ones, but maybe they want people to record and populate extra fields. And that might be a reason why you would use different apps. But for general purposes, you know, I just like iNat.
Yeah, and I'll second that, because there's also Bumblebee Watch, which is a lot more cumbersome to add things, but functionally it doesn't add any more archived information than iNaturalist does. There are different versions of, they're not called iNaturalist in Europe, that are a little bit different than the version, or it's a different architecture, but collects most of the same information. But if you actually drill down, iNaturalist is one of the easiest ones to use. And it would be a shame if we around the world end up with three or four different independent sets of archives rather than coordinating them. At least that's my opinion anyway.
Does anybody wish to have assistance after this evening with getting set up on iNaturalist? Or maybe if you have all kinds of old photos and you wish to share them, or maybe there are other photos in the society's archives that could be uploaded. There's all kinds of possibilities.
That would be an enormous task.
Lots of time. I'm avoiding doing income tax.
So 620,000 photographs.
Yeah.
Yep. A brief note on Eisner's Marsh. Bob Bancroft has just sent a letter to HRM Council. Regards preservation of Eisner's Marsh and the threat that the proposed development has to it. So there is a lot going on about that marsh.
Maybe it's an opportunity to get people out and go for a little wander through it over the next while. The first time I think I went on it, it was, I think it was through Ducks Unlimited, and they were going out with a group who were exploring different areas on by the bus. I forget what it was called at the moment, but they would organize groups and find a bus that would take them somewhere, an HRM bus. So Mary, would you like to discuss your trees at all, or is that your trail trees?
Sorry, I had to figure out how to unmute myself, Mary. So Mary Kennedy has kindly volunteered to help me do something I've been trying to do unsuccessfully. And that is, most of you guys know that I have been following trail trees and have been observing some very interesting characteristics of the trail trees, but I have no way of right now of mapping trail trees in our region and inviting other people to do this and adding their characteristics into the list. So that what I would love to do is I would love to do a search for example, balsam fir trail trees that are about 120 years old within a specific small area. Because from my observations, those trees were probably planted all by the same person. I have no way to do a search for that. I could do a search for balsam fir trees in that area. I have no way of inviting people across Nova Scotia or the whole region to identify culturally modified trees.
You're looking for old balsam fir trees?
Oh, trail trees. So it was, I didn't know what a trail tree was until this afternoon when I was getting distracted. I was supposed to be preparing this presentation, but I went off to go learn about trail trees. So Mary had given a very good presentation, I think, to this group about these trees in one of the past meetings. And they're basically trees that have been modified so that they, you know, they have big, the branches point in different directions so that you can tell which way you're supposed to be going or look from this tree to another tree. And anyway, they are modified in that somebody did trim a few branches at some point. So Mary has posted many pictures of these on iNaturalist. And in her description, it says something like trail tree. So I was able to go through and filter based on her username and the species of tree and look for where she had put this little note in her description so I could filter these out. But I think what has to happen first is because iNaturalist is based on the species of tree, that there should be a grouping of views in those observations. So there should be one that's close up that just says, hey, I'm a balsam fir tree, and people can identify that. And then the second tree or second photo would be like what David was mentioning, almost like the sort of the habitat or the background view of something of the whole tree. And then you could add a story about that particular tree and say what kind of a marker tree it was. And that would work.
Mary, can't you add a specific tag?
Yes.
So you could, if you had a specific tag and everybody did that, then you can group other people's observations under that tag, I believe.
That's right. You can filter it. And then once you've filtered it, then you can add all these manually to a project.
Mary?
Yep.
I think you can also create a project, but you'd have to have a project where you select the project when you put a...
Yes.
And if you look at, I believe Burkhart has started a project on exotic trees in HRM. And I think you could probably do it the same way he did that project.
Yeah, no, it does have to be what they call the old legacy kind of projects, because it used to be very painful. You had to actually take your observation, say, hey, I want to add it to that project. But you can do this in batch mode now. So it's possible, but you just have to make sure that there are tags or there's a description or words somewhere that you can filter it. You have to be able to filter it.
See, Mary, I have no problem finding my trail trees. That's not the issue. It's that I want to find them across the whole region, which means I need to be able to invite other people to do this.
That's right. And But what you would do then is on your project, and that's why you would create a project, because you want to share information with the community about something you're interested in. So you'd write a post and say, hey, when you're out wandering through the woods, and you know, can you see any of these trees? Because I've never seen one, but I've never looked for one. I didn't know they existed. So that now we have a new challenge. We can go out and start looking for them. And then when we do find them, we'll follow the directions that you'll have on your project page, which will say, add this tag or add these words to your description, and then they can be easily found.
Well, wonderful. If you ever have a moment to spare to help me set something like that up, I would be so grateful, because I'll tell you why, is because these are very culturally significant, and they embed a lot of information that is endangered because they're a living legacy that the older they are, the more information that they have, and they're in endangered forests.
Yep.
Well, yes, I guess it's probably quite obvious. Some of the things I've been finding now that I know about these trees is I've even found what I believe are trail tree nurseries, which is I'm walking along very, very long traditional trails, like trails that would have probably been portage routes or whatever. I'm finding little ponds, little sheltered ponds by the sides of these trails every 100 paces or so that seem to have potentially been used maybe by granddad and grandson. So granddad had his maybe red spruce trees that he used as a trail tree, and grandson, whom he was training to do this, had his little balsam fir trees in there, and they would nurse them in these little ponds so they wouldn't have to carry a whole bunch of them all the way down the trail. So there's so much embedded information in these trail trees, and I'm really, really worried about them. So
Are there likely to find any trail trees within HRM or the Valley or Cape Breton?
As long as you've got old forest where Ulnug lived, it's been my experience that yes, you will find trail trees.
Okay. So it is something that we could promote and try to encourage people to look for during the City Nature Challenge.
Oh, it would be wonderful.
Okay. I'm going to put, you had a link here for your trees. I'm just going to put that in the chat here.
And I'm using a very simple, in my comments in iNaturalist, I just use TT for trail tree. I use MD for mound because I find burial mounds, but I'm not so worried about those because they show up very clearly on LIDAR anomalies, but there's nothing. The only way that we can find these trail trees is field work. There's right. not there. And that's the only way we can monitor them. We have to identify them and then we have to monitor them because otherwise we're going to lose them all because they lost this tradition in the 1940s, 50s, 60s, when they, you know, with the cultural erasure due to residential schools.
I mean, I think I'd recommend to people that are interested, have a look at the YouTube that I just put there in the chat. It was very informative. Now, I'd like to say that I don't know if you're counting the number of times I say City Nature Challenge, but this year I had the logo translated into Mi'kmaq. So this would be a great way to use it. I also had to translate into Gaelic because it's already in English, it's in French, it's in the bilingual version, it's in Spanish, it's in Arabic, Chinese, there's many, many versions, but I thought it'd be important to have it in Mi'kmaq. So looking for some uses for it. So now we're going out looking for balsam fir, and we're going to Eisner's Cove as part of the City Nature Challenge. We're looking for five different kinds of lichen. And can we look for some moss? Because I know that I probably misidentify a number of moss that I post. Are there some really obvious ones that anybody can't go wrong with?
Sorry, Mary, I have to interrupt just to make sure that you understand. They're not just balsam fir.
Yes.
They range. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, good. I've even found in very old forests, I've even found eastern hemlock trail trees and red spruce trail trees. They're very rare. Okay.
Mary, are most of the trees you're looking at as trail trees balsam fir?
Yes, because as the forest was degraded, It seems that the balsam fir was more prevalent. Yeah.
Well, the average lifespan of balsam fir is about 100 years, and they die naturally.
Yeah, exactly.
So they don't last that long.
Yeah.
So they can't be very much old growth.
Exactly, Charles. So the older the forest, that, for example, the one that I just went to the other day down in Markland, which is near the Caribou Mines, near the mining, there's some very old forest there. And it seems that the way the culture passed along this tradition was you would choose your species as a child. And then your species would be something that you would plant during your lifetime, and you would look after these trees. And in this very old forest, for that reason, I was seeing very old eastern hemlock, not quite so old red spruce, not quite so old as that black spruce, you know, and it was going, I had never seen so many different age classes of trail tree. And this is why I'm saying it's so valuable that we identify the forests that are old that host these trees.
That's interesting. So basically people were continually renewing these trees. As they died, they would plant a new one.
Yes, exactly. Yes. If one of the trees that you planted passed away or didn't work, you would plant it, you would replace it when you were alive with the same species you were tending in your tree nursery with your grandfather.
I have a question. Is it possible to get a copy of the comments in the chat thing after the meeting is over? Are they recorded?
I'm running this chat thing on my screen. Now, whether the recording records that, I'm not sure. I don't know. If it doesn't, I don't know how you would.
You can copy and paste them.
Yes, just copy the whole lot of them, eh? Yeah. Yeah, just scroll through and copy the whole lot. Okay.
So that has to be done before you turn everything off.
Yeah, so I'll do that before I turn, before I end the meeting then.
Because there might have been a couple of questions that I missed.
Yeah.
Bob, are we paying for that Zoom?
Yes.
Because the paid version, I think you can get a printout of the whole thing.
Really?
I believe so.
Okay. Well, I'll
you can get it like a transcript of the whole thing.
Okay, well, right now I'm going to copy everything just so I got it. Yeah, I've heard of getting a transcript, but I think, does the transcript include the comments?
I think it does. It should, because it's used in business meetings and stuff. Okay.
Anyway, I just took the comments we have and I cut and pasted them to Word, and that seems to work. So I'll save that as well. I'll play around it and see if I can see there's another way of doing it, but I do have a copy now in Word. So I'll post that. If all else fails, I'll post that.
One of the BC Parks blog posts was about posting old observations. And I know that many people have a lot of these. But anyway, it had a very good YouTube clip of somebody who was going back and uploading his 30 years of observations. It's something that can be done. I know I went back through a trip that we made to Scotland a couple of years ago, and that was kind of fun going through and looking at the pictures of where we explored, but also looking to see how many different species of different things we found. So then that led me to a trip we made to the Arctic once in 1980 on the Hudson. And unfortunately, all my pictures of the wild flora are kind of fuzzy, out of focus, so not of much value.
I think you guys might be interested to know, I don't think I mentioned it at my last talk because I wasn't sure. And because we're having the mistletoe guy on next month, it'll be something for us to ask him about as well, is that in some of these sites that are clearly associated with what I call circle scars, their hearth scars of village sites, especially in Antigonish and Guysburg County, I'm seeing burl trees with the burls at about the height of maybe like up to your chest height. That's where most of the burls are. And doing a little bit of investigation, I mean, we all know that the burl can be caused by disease, but you can also manipulate the growing stem of the tree. They're mostly on spruce. Spruce and balsam fir, I've seen them on, but mostly spruce. If you manipulate it, you can trigger a burl. And so this is why I'm thinking culturally modified trees is something that I want to have as the project, as opposed to trail tree, because these burl trees, I think definitely were culturally modified. And the ones that where it really made me turn my head were there was a huge number of them. The trees are extremely healthy, so they're not diseased. In Antigonish, right next to the shore, Mary, and the shore was and I probably still is a hot spot for quahog. And part of the bow drill toolkit for making wampum was a tree burl. And during the 1600s and 1700s, there were counterfeit wampum sites along the shore. And this looks like it might have been at one of these counterfeit wampum factories. There's some other evidence there as well that would indicate that. So yeah, so very, very interesting. So here we're looking at another type of potentially culturally modified tree.
And I think this is, you know, one of the powers of iNaturalist, because it's however people wish to connect with nature, you know, so your reason for going out and exploring and looking at certain things are probably very different from what someone else might be doing, but you're collecting the data and it can be used for all kinds of different purposes. So it's great. There are, it is possible to add all kinds of extra fields to iNaturalist, but it's, I'm not sure of the great value for that if everybody is, unless people are choosing certain fields to populate that are common. And I think that's why a few years ago, iNat went through and added a few of the attributes. If you look at animals, say you can add that they're dead or alive, and I don't know if that's because I pestered them forever because I wanted to be able to say that something was just a shell. I thought that would be simple. And then that's where it got into the assigning gender of male or female. And that's why you should be adding individual pictures of the different sexes instead of a giant group if you want to assign gender. I have to say gender instead of sex because years ago when we were talking about vocabularies, and corresponding with somebody in England trying to figure out how to figure out those terms and whether to say male or female or capital M, capital F or whatever it was. And I said, I'm not sure how to put this in the subject line for my email to you, because it might get flagged by DFO. But he sort of replied with, we here in England say gender. So that's why. Does anybody have any specific questions about how to upload to iNaturalist, or are there still issues with trying to assign a location? Is everybody quite familiar with it? Everybody's gone?
No. I think I'm comfortable. Sorry, I was.
Yeah. Yep.
Mary, that was really interesting. I found it interesting. You haven't persuaded me yet to sign up for iNet. I just find that I'm so busy with collecting and identifying, using my microscope. But sometimes I only do one specimen a day.
Yeah, it's not for everybody, you know, and there's no need for it to be for everybody. But you know, as long as the stuff that you're collecting is being, you know, preserved somewhere and maybe shared with a museum or something at some point, that is fine. But you know, if I can persuade you to come out for 4 days or at least one day during the City Nature Challenge, you may have to cross a county line or two to get within one of the locations. And that's one of the comments that I had from several people who don't live within those areas. Like, why is it not across the whole province? But it's just a 4-day event of a challenge. So if people can get out and cross into the you know, either the valley or cross from, you know, Hans County into Kings, that'd be great. Or to cross from Victoria County into Cape Breton or you know, come to HRM. It's good. But if you can't make it there and or don't really want to be posting observations, maybe you can help monitor content that other people are sharing. And so say, hey, look, you forgot to post a really obvious species. You know, add that to your list. Say, it's a challenge. And we do want to, beat Cape Breton. Is Cape Breton listening there? But we do also want to encourage, you know, people in the valley to get out. And I know a lot of the valley people live in Digby, but so they do have to cross over into Annapolis. But I don't think that's too much of a hardship for them. They can go over for 4 days and then come back and use iNat in their area for the rest of the time. Yes, David. The other thing is to say that this is an opportunity to explore your backyard, explore other parks, or go to a new area. And I keep trying to promote, you know, Abrams Lake. It's a great area to go. It's a little bit far away for most people, but it is a Nature Conservancy Canada location that does fall within one of these City Nature Challenge areas, HRM. Did you wish to say something, David? So Jillian, where are you located?
Hi, I'm in Halifax, Mary.
Okay, great.
Yeah, I've just used iNaturalist for the first time, looking just now from what you've shown us and looking through the forum that has all these videos on how to start using it and avoid common mistakes. So that's brilliant. Thank you. Yeah, this is very helpful. Thank you. Thank you, Mary. This is great. Yeah.
And when you're on iNet, you can just send me a message. I'm just MK Kennedy. I couldn't get away from the Mary Kay no matter what I did. So
I saw that you're under the birds part, that I think it was the eBirds on iNaturalist, that you're listed as one of the major contributors. So is that part of eBirds or is that just?
No, it's what it is. Trying to put content somewhere that you can reference, like what should you do if you're sharing to multiple databases? Right. And so that was just some suggestions.
Okay. So as a beginner birder, that section is probably useful for me to use around HRM.
Yes, I find iNaturalist great for birding if you have a real camera. Maybe not if you're using the app.
I don't have a real camera, but I have a smartphone.
Okay. Yeah. You can also record sounds. You can try that and try uploading those. They might take a little bit longer to get identified, but I tried the other day to take a picture, sound recording of the sparrow on my front deck, but the chickadee kept interrupting. So it's a little bit of practice.
Yeah. Well, this is great to sort of have a hands-on demo of how it works.
Yep. there's we tried to have a lunch and learn session a couple of weeks ago, and a few of us got together. The idea was that we were going to look at the identify feature that they have in iNaturalist. And when you do that, you can decide you want to review observations that other people have looked at, or you want to look at ones that nobody has assigned a name to. So we thought, well, maples, they have to be simple. So anyway, it wasn't quite so simple, but we did manage to go through and we identified a number of issues with either what people are posting or what features needed to be included to facilitate the identification. So this is something I think that would be useful, and it never hurts anyway for a group to get together. And instead of speaking face-to-face like this, we opened a browser and then we would go through and we'd poke at different observations, and couldn't figure out what it was, we just skipped, because, you know, there's hundreds or thousands of them. So we could go through it, you know, county by county or different backyards.
Well, I live near Fern Lane, and I just noticed on the it's like looking at the car share, there's just so many. So somebody obviously at the Ecology Action Center had a project, and so hundreds.
And that's why if you look at, I broke HRM down into the various electoral districts, because I wanted to compare what Dartmouth was sharing versus Bedford or Sackville or the Eastern Shore. And if you look at the original observations, you'll see that downtown Halifax has a lot. But that's because every BioBlitz that was ever held in Nova Scotia always had a component in Point Pleasant Park, always. And so now we're trying to do a little bit more focus on Blue Mountain Birch Cove, and we'll be giving them, the only time that they have free for me to give presentations night before City Nature Challenge starts. So that should be good to get them out there. But trying to come up with ways, can you use iNaturalist as a land steward? So, you know, is this an easy way to record what you see? And it means that you don't necessarily need to be a taxonomic expert to do it. But, you know, you will learn and you can encourage others to share.
But that's terrific. I'd love to go out on that.
Yeah.
So that's the Blue Mountain Birch Cove.
Yes. No, it's going to be another Zoom meeting.
Okay. So. And you're doing it on the 28th.
Yes.
Great. So
now the invasive species, I think that was also mentioned on the society's webpage that they're having big meetings coming up. So I contacted them to see if they wanted to promote iNat. So of course I have to give another talk. So I'm going to get a little bit better because talking is not really my forte. Or completed sentences are not really what I specialize in. But I keep trying to encourage other people to use iNaturalist and to promote it, but it always seems to come back at me. They say, oh yeah, great, you wanna do it? Okay. So David, do you have any words of wisdom that you wanna share?
I sort of. Can we go back to the session we did on maples? And I think it shows a few things that are important. I think iNaturalist is partly sold as it'll help you identify, but if you do not make the observation with the appropriate characters, iNaturalist is not going to save you and help you with identifications. So from my point of view, it's really important when you are making an observation, make sure you take pictures of the characters you need to identify. So you can identify all the maples in Nova Scotia in the winter with no leaves if you take the right photos. Red maples have big bulging red buds. The bark is different between sugar maple and Norway maple. And, you know, box elder is different. And so you can identify them all, but you have to take photos of the right characters. And it really, like, if you think, if somebody just shows you one photo, you're gonna struggle to figure out what it is. But if you have clear photos of the bark, the twigs, the overall tree and the habitat, you can identify probably 95% of the maples in Nova Scotia. But if you're gonna take a picture from your car as you're driving by at 60 kilometers an hour, you know, just give up. and if you go through iNaturalist, I mean, I think that's what we've, is Ron still here? Yeah, Ron and Mary and who else, Kevin was on too, I think. You know, those, there's a lot of observations. If you do not take care with the observation, you're not really going to be satisfied with the identification. So you have to take some care, and then you can get it. And to go, like Mary McCauley was asking about, you know, documenting trail trees. If you document trail trees, if you take three or four photos showing the characters to identify the tree, the characters that show that it's clearly a trail tree, and your phone has GPS on it, you've just documented, geolocated it, and iNaturalist saves all that for you. So it's done. But the key thing is you've got to take the photos that clearly show those, or not even clearly, but at least half-ass show those characters. And if you do that, iNaturalist is superb. And the other thing I'll point out, and I'll distinguish myself from Ann Mills, who puts a lot of serious work, and each of her observations and identifications takes an awful lot of effort, and that is really important. And that sort of work is the basis that underpins iNaturalist. But the one thing iNaturalist can do in volume is, you know, if you look through professional collections, how many colt's foot or dandelions or black knapweed do they have? Not very many. That's one area that iNaturalist can do very well. You know, if you look at Flora of Nova Scotia and published floras, that sort of thing, real botanists don't really care about those things, but that's something iNaturalist can do. And I might be accused of oversaturating iNaturalist with coltsfoot observations, but I now know where coltsfoot occurs in Cape Breton, which I don't think there's any place else except for iNaturalist that you can go and find that. So I would argue that it's sort of the commoner's approach to plant distributions, as opposed to the high quality stuff that, you know, people like Sean Blaney and Ann Mills and Sean Hoy and Alain Bellevaux do. It's different, but I think they complement each other.
Dave. The other Dave Patrick pointed a place where you put which pictures to take, how to take pictures for plants. If you look on the chat.
Yes, and I think I figured out how to save that, so I will do that.
Yeah, I just did that actually for the Eisner Cove people, just to give them some idea of, you know, what to take when they really don't, when they don't have botanical experience. So it's just some basic things that could be taken. And my point there was that somebody who's skilled at identifying things can take one picture and they know what picture to take. That's a definitive record of that species. But if you don't have that kind of background, you really, you know, you take one picture, the likelihood is not going to work. So anyway, I just put some hints down there about what to take if you didn't have a background in identifying things.
That will come with practice.
It does. It also encourages, or people should be encouraged to look at their dashboard and see the comments that others have made. Because, you know, if you look at your observations, you see none of them are getting identified, then ask yourself the question, why not? One of the other things that we did at the beginning of this year for iNaturalist Canada, they do have a blog page apparently. So I thought that January 1st, everybody should make goals for 2022 and come up with ideas of things that you can do relate to iNaturalist. So I said that I was going to read a little bit more about what other people are doing as iNaturalists. And I quoted Zach Metcalf, his paper, once again, a few years ago. I don't know if people read that. He wrote an article that so many people can identify 150 logos as they're walking down the street, whether it's McDonald's or Tim Hortons or Esso or whatever it is, but they can't name 10 plants, you know, so there's something wrong with that. So he set out to try to find 150 different species. And so this is a challenge I think that a lot of people have these days. They say, I want to find these species. And there is actually a Canada Day challenge. It started out with 150. Now I think we're at 154 or something species that you have to find on that one day. So it makes for great family life on July 1st when you're out looking for different species. But I think Kevin was very good. He posted a challenge for the year to find a guidebook that you really like and see how many species in that guidebook that you can find in your area. So it's just a, you know, whatever excuse you want to have to get outdoors and to participate.
So are you going to put a promo in for the 8-kilometer challenge, Mary?
Look, give me the 5-mile one.
I do 8 kilometers. You can do 5 miles.
They also have one with COVID. They're trying to still get people to go out and explore your backyard or however far you could walk. So they have this, because I think it's more than Canada, isn't it? It's called the 5-mile radius thing. So you have your central location, that's your house, and then create a polygon that's 5-mile radius. And then it counts the number of observations or keeps track of the number of observations you have within that area. And I will say, I think that David is winning. I think he's quite far ahead of me. So it's only by a couple of thousand.
Yeah, there's a couple of young people in Ontario that, as far as species, have way more. But being old and sedentary, I have far more observations. But then there's a lot of colt's foot in there and Iceland gulls.
A few Iceland gulls, yeah. People may not realize, but it's not that Dave just wants to up his count of Iceland gulls. He is actually looking at the molting pattern of individual birds. And that's why it's important to have, just have a big black spot. So it's important to monitor the same bird day after day after day after day, because they do change. So it's fun. It's a challenge. And then sometimes you might be competing with a different area or maybe a specific person. So you can follow them, see, you know, what were they doing today? How did they get those observations? It was minus 40 outside, you know, so it's helpful.
Well, I'm thinking, it's 9:30 here. Covered everything, do you think, or?
I'm sure there's lots that we didn't cover, but it's starting the conversation, you know, If people want to get together in smaller Zoom groups and chat or discuss issues or things like iNat's not going to replace traditional surveys, but it is another tool, and it's another layer of data that people can take and you know, plot and then say, hey, let's go look at this and fill in some gaps.
That chat is what we miss from our museum meetings.
Yeah.
It's true, yeah. Well, everybody's got to, everybody's worried about getting home in time for the museum meeting, and here you just got to sign off. Yeah. But I think, I mean, from my standpoint, Mary, this has been very good. Like, particularly with sort of some of the other, reaching into some of the other capabilities of iNaturalist and just kind of rethinking how you approach it in that. I think this has been a very good evening for that. I know I'm going to go back and, like, I hadn't really noticed the attributes thing. So I'm going to go back in a lot of my stuff and just start to see about enhancing some of the information on them, maybe with the attributes and that, so that those little graphs start looking better.
Yeah. Yes. You know, and I say it's very easy. Like when you start identifying, like I don't feel qualified to identify anything. You know, and my background was, you know, looking in a microscope and looking at the fifth hair on the fourth appendage of the whatever. You know, so I know how to do it. I just don't want to do it. But it's I forget where I was going. But it's easy enough if you look at some of those observations. Someone said, hey, it's an unknown. You know, I can say it's a plant, you know, or I can say I think it's a maple. You know, I can get down to a certain level. I can say it's a crustacean or something along that line. So you can always add a bit of value. Mm-hmm. There's also trying to encourage a lot of youth to get out and to get them observing nature and sharing observations. So working with Hike Nova Scotia, they've changed their youth distance challenge badge where they have to hike so many kilometers. And it used to be that they had to do a couple of other activities. And one was to draw pictures of plants or animals that they saw when they were out exploring. And also they had to maybe in preparation read the Leave No Trace principles. So we've got them to change that. So now instead of drawing pictures, they can also upload photos or observations to iNaturalist. Hmm. They can also then go and explore iNat before they go out. So if they're going out to Salt Marsh Trail, what species might they see? Where is that poison ivy? You know, things along that line. So then Nature Nova Scotia is working with Hike Nova Scotia to create a new challenge crest that's going to be for biodiversity objectives. So it's spreading the word to anybody and everybody, you know, whether it's gardeners, bikers, walkers, anybody. Could it even be for birders? You know, what tree was that bird sitting on top of?
Yeah, good point. Yeah. So I think we're starting to lose people here, so I think it's time to wrap up. Anything do you want to say anything about the next meeting, Charles, or anything?
Well, our next meeting is going to be March the 28th. And I believe it's going to be Bob Guska talking to us about mistletoe and skunk cabbage. I'll have more details a little later.
Yeah. Okay, well, I'll put it on the website as soon as I can.
Okay. I'll let you know.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Mary. That was excellent.
Yeah, really well. You covered a lot of ground there. That was a great job. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, thanks for the opportunity.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Good night.
Okay.
Thanks, folks. Good night.
Okay. Good night, all. Let me just save the chat. No.